Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, to our webinar, China Revising TB Regulations to Embrace BEPS, Implication on German Multinationals in China. Yeah, we thought this time that we have our webinar in English and that we give you an overview about our the latest developments in China. Obviously, China is very, very important to the German industry, and therefore we were glad that this grabbed your attention, and that again a very impressive number of people joined our webinar. So we have three prominent speakers today who will guide you through the new guidelines, which we expect to come out very soon. First of all, I welcome my partner colleague in Beijing, Qisheng Yu. Qisheng has a very strong background in transfer pricing controversy, supporting a lot of companies, multinationals, in tax audit defense, in mutual agreement procedure. Qisheng, I would say, unfortunately, not too many with Germany, as there are only very few, but we will cover and talk about that later. And we see also an increasing trend on APAs, where Qisheng is also involved in a German, in one of the very few German bilateral APAs. So Qisheng is also the best person to talk to you about the latest developments because he has very close contact to the Chinese tax authorities who are legislator, who are drafting the new regulations to react on BEPS. Then I have also two of my colleagues here in Germany with me. That's Yu Tao, a senior manager in our Frankfurt office. Yu Tao has worked for many years in China and now is since 5 years in Germany in our Frankfurt team, acting as a senior manager working on a quite large number of Chinese-German projects. And then we have also Eva Kiyang with us. She is a TP manager in Munich, and as Yu Tao, she has worked for many years in our China practice and then moved to Germany and is now working since 4 years in our German practice and supporting our clients in South Germany on Chinese and other tax issues, transfer pricing issues. Okay, so we put together, I hope, an interesting agenda for you. We will start to give you an update where we are with the new Chinese transfer pricing regulations. So Qisheng is, I think, the best person to talk about those topics and to cover that. And then we would like to spend a few minutes on the implication on German multinationals. We have thought a bit of what are the most prominent issues we come across in our day-to-day work and have spelled out five major bullet points which we would like to discuss with you. And then at the end we have a Q&A session. So we are welcoming you to use the chat functionality. It's on the bottom right side. You can type in your question. I'll collect them. I cannot promise that we cover all of them because we reserved 5 to 10 minutes for the questions. But what I can promise is that if we have not covered it on our webinar, we drop you an email. At least if you are registered, then I can see your name. So that's important. If you are registered, I see your name, then I will cover that either today or we send you an email afterwards to answer your questions. Or if you prefer not to use the chat functionality, you can send me an email to the email address events.de@de.pwc.com. So again, the email address would be events.de@de.pwc.com. Okay, so I think then let's start with the with the update on the Chinese TP regulations. So first, Yu Tao would give you some background about the new regulations.
Good morning, everyone. I would like to give you a background about this new the regulation that is being amended, so that you understand the whole picture. Then we will go on with Qishen. Qishen will provide you more detailed updates from his side. The regulation we are talking about is the circular number 2. It was issued in 2009, the original version. It is a regulation that is the most important transfer pricing regulations in China. It provides detailed, maybe not so detailed as the German laws, but detailed guidance over the definition of related parties, contemporaneous documentation requirements and procedure, and the related party transaction filing requirements, which the companies have to file at yearly tax filing. It also touches on the procedure for TP audits and adjustments. It touches on the APAs and cost sharing agreements. It also addresses the CFC rules for China, thin capitalization rules and the management, as well as a general anti-avoidance rules. So this is a very important regulation. And now, with the conclusion of the BEPS initiative at a OECD and at G20 level, China is very keen to amend this regulation in line with the BEPS results. So at the end, in end of 2015, that was last year, September, China released a initial draft for the amendments to this circular number 2, which is requiring a public feedback. We understand that there have been several rounds of discussions internally between the legislation, or to say the rule making bodies within China, and there were internal and official updates of this rule amendment being unofficially discussed. So we are expecting that it's likely very soon there will be a circular, not at the full scale of amendment for circular number 2, will come out first to have the detailed guidance on TP documentation and the related party transaction filing requirements. That will come first, it's very likely. And then when the different stakeholders reach agreement on the final amendments, then the other parts of the amendments will be issued later. So this is the status. And what we see, this would have an outcome, an implication on our German multinational that have operations in China, is that by bringing into the BEPS consideration, there is an escalation of transparency requirement and the filing requirement and documentation requirements. And we see that this could lead to higher burdensome compliance needs on the China subsidiary or Chinese operation side. And on the other hand, we also see that China is keen to move on to a more holistic approach, looking at a global value chain and consider what China's share of these values would be. As a result, the German multinationals may want to take care of any, have to revisit their existing transfer pricing structure concerning China. So with that, I'm going to pass on to Qishen, our Chinese partner, so he'll give you an update on the new regulation, the drafted amendment.
Thank you, Yu. Good morning, good afternoon, everyone, wherever you are. In the following few minutes, we'll give you an update on the Chinese transfer pricing regulation development. As an overview, the discussion draft that we mentioned earlier essentially added three chapters to the existing transfer pricing regulation. And these new chapters focus on intangibles, integral services, and profit level monitoring of taxpayers. These are indicating the Chinese tax authority's recent emphasis on these areas. the discussion draft also introduced a master file, local file, as well as country-by-country reporting, and it introduced a transfer pricing method on which many have raised concerns. So we will discuss them a little bit later. The discussion draft also expanded the transfer pricing audit procedures to cover all special tax adjustment investigations. These other special tax adjustment areas include CFC rules, thin capitalization rules, and general anti-avoidance rules related matters. Releasing the disruption draft, a major circular such as Circular 2 for public consultation is actually not common in China, given the importance and potentially broad impact of Circular 2 on both Chinese and foreign multinational, such as STEP is welcomed. The SAT originally planned to finalize the revised Circular 2 by the end of 2015 and didn't happen, mainly because the consultation within the government bodies are continuing. It is now expected that instead of issuing the revised Circular 2 in one go, as you mentioned earlier, there will be several chapters of the discussion draft that will be finalized first and released as separate circulars. That's the current understanding. And one of the separate circulars will likely be the new transfer pricing documentation and reporting requirements, as well as potentially a separate circular on procedures regarding the application of advanced pricing arrangement, as well as competent assistance under the mutual agreement procedures. And these new circulars will likely take effect for 2016 tax year. So even though it will be released sometime this year. The discussion draft clarified the related party transaction as we see in the next slide. So the current criteria of 25% direct or indirect common ownership remains as constituting related party relationship, but the discussion draft provides more clarity on some other relationship, such as family relationship, financing or management control, that may also constitute as a basis to form a related party relationship. With respect to the related party transactions, cash pooling and equity share transfer are introduced into the scope of related party transactions and therefore subject to transfer pricing rules, including the transfer pricing documentation requirements. The transfer pricing documentation requirements are expected to expand in several ways. The discussion draft introduced the master file and local file as part of the TP documentation requirement and requiring taxpayer meeting the current threshold of 200 million RMB for tangible goods transaction and 40 million RMB for other intercompany transactions to prepare both master file and local file. The threshold in the final documentation requirement, however, is expected to change with a higher threshold for master file than the current 200 million RMB. The content of the master file is expected to follow the OECD recommendation, which is a welcoming news to multinationals, as the discussion draft contained actually some additional requirement, which now we expect may not necessarily show in the final regulation. The content of the local file, however, is expected to be much expanded from the current existing requirement as contained in Circular 2. The taxpayer, whether full-fledged or contract manufacturer or limited distributor, is expected to have a value chain analysis describing the group's value chain, its participants, and the profit allocation principle, as well as the result of these value chain participants. The taxpayer is also expected to describe whether location-specific advantages exist and how they have affected the taxpayer's contribution to the value creation of the group, and whether any comparability adjustment has been made when evaluating its transfer pricing. The related party disclosure form will also be much more extensive to include as many as more than 20 forms from the current 9 forms. So the taxpayer is expected to submit more information upfront along with its tax returns. The country-by-country reporting will be required and announced by on May 12th this year. China has signed the multilateral competent authority agreement for the automatic exchange of country-by-country reports. Now, in addition to the 5 traditional methods, which are consistent with the OECD guidelines, the discussion draft included 2 new transfer pricing methods. One is applicable to valuation of intangibles and equity transfers. The other method is called value creation attribution method, or value contribution attribution method, which has caused quite a stir to the international tax community, mainly because the method, according to the discussion draft, will be applicable when transactions have no appropriate comparables to evaluate, but the consolidated group profit and value contribution could be reasonably recognized. Under such a method, the MNC's consolidated profit may be allocated based on each party's contribution to value creation to the multinational group. How that method is going to be applied and whether that method will survive in the final draft remain to be seen, but the indications are that the final regulation may not necessarily include this method. The discussion draft also provided further details on the investigation procedures to cover not only transfer pricing investigation, but also other special tax adjustment in investigations. One of the areas that the discussion draft included is regarding the corresponding accounting adjustment, also related to the secondary adjustment issues as a result of a transfer pricing adjustment. This issue has been subject to much debate, and the debate may not necessarily settle soon, so it's also possible that this issue may not have a final answer in the final regulations. Regarding the capital working capital adjustment, China generally does not allow working capital adjustment except for a toll manufacturing situation where the prevailing practice in China is that for toll manufacturers, the material cost need to be added back to its cost base when calculate its markup. And in that situation, working capital adjustment may still be allowed. That certainly is quite controversial in some other countries, but that's nevertheless the current practice in China. Continue on to the next slide. The discussion draft also contained several other very important topic, two of which, as we mentioned earlier, actually is reflected in the two new chapters, the intangibles as well as the intergroup services. The intangibles, this discussion draft has incorporated much of the principles as contained in the latest OECD BEPS outcome. For example, only providing funding for intangible development is not sufficient for intangibles ownership. However, the discussion draft went further on some other areas. For example, one of the areas in the OECD is regarding the important function, which is now commonly referred as DAMP functions relating to intangibles. These include development, enhancement, maintenance, protection, and exploitation of intangibles. The discussion draft added another important function which China feels is very important, that is the promotion of intangibles as another important function. Those areas, as we are awaiting the final regulation, will have a significant impact on transfer pricing for multinationals, because in the last several years, China has been very much focusing on intangibles as well as location-specific advantages, and often on the basis there's no good local comparable companies. More and more tax authorities are arguing for a profit, an application of a profit split, rather than a traditionally transactional net margin method being the dominant transfer pricing method utilized by the multinationals. And a more holistic analysis value creation and value chain has been repeatedly emphasized by the Chinese tax authorities. This has also been fully reflected in the discussion draft. Regarding the special tax adjustment investigation, as we mentioned earlier, the location saving, market intangible, and market premiums are the factors that tax authority have repeatedly asked taxpayer to demonstrate and how they have affected the transfer pricing. And in the application of advanced pricing and other procedures, taxpayer are required to analyze these issues and demonstrate whether any comparability adjustment has been indeed used. Now, regarding the APA, the regulation laid out several criteria as to being the priority factors that the Chinese tax authority would look at when they evaluate and assess whether a particular application will be accepted. In China, applying for an ATA requires the tax authority's approval, and given the limited resources faced by the tax authorities, prioritizing the application has been a challenge for many multinational taxpayers who are very much interested in applying and utilizing the APA program. And one of the criteria that the Chinese tax authority that use is whether the taxpayer has provided a clear analysis and description of the value chain of the multinational group, and another area being whether the location specific advantages and market premiums have been fully analyzed and have reflected in the proposed transfer pricing method. Going on to the next slide, we also want to touch base on some other areas, one of which is cost sharing arrangement. The draft simplified the procedures and enhanced the administration of cost sharing arrangement. In the existing circular, a taxpayer who is implementing a cost sharing arrangement actually need to register the arrangement with the tax authority, essentially requiring an approval in order to secure the deduction of the cost incurred for the cost sharing arrangement. Under the discussion draft, that registration or approval-like requirement is no longer there, but simply replaced with a documentation requirement, which was in existence in the existing requirement. Sufficient documentation, therefore, is necessary still and need to be available and provided upon request to the tax authorities. Other areas is of importance and of interest to multinationals, taxpayer is the profit level monitoring. In the last several years, the tax authority has very much focused on the risk assessment of the taxpayers, and they often remind the taxpayer of the potential transfer pricing risk, as well as to remind the tax the possibility to make a self-adjustment, either on the tax return or post tax return filing, but before they initiate a transfer pricing investigation. This close monitoring of taxpayers' profit level is a new way for Chinese tax authority to enforce the transfer pricing regulations, even though at the moment the formal transfer pricing audit in terms of number, it stays relatively stable at around 200 cases a year. But the self-adjustment actually accounted for almost like 70% of the total transfer pricing related adjustment tax, additional tax payable that occur every year. So the monitoring the profit level of the taxpayer and reminding the taxpayer's transfer pricing risk and being a taxpayer being requested to make self-adjustment is something that we expect to continue. Back to you, Axel.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Kisheng, for that. Well, I think from what you're saying, it doesn't hit me as a surprise. It sounds like ingoing flows like service transactions, intangibles, all the arguments which are provided in the OECD guidelines is picked up by the Chinese tax authorities, which of course is one of the factors which will have an impact on the on German multinationals. So we put together some bullet points, Yutao and Eva, what you experience in your day-to-day practice when you discuss with German multinationals on their Chinese investments. So would you guide us through the main points we see?
Thanks, Axel. In the next slides, we are going to go through the hottest topics that that we see the German multinationals are interested in. These discussions on these topics have been through both without client work and as well as with internal colleagues discussion between within PwC. So we see that the most interesting topics are identified as, for example, the IP license, how to deal with in the China context, how to set the level of royalty, and can you make a fluctuating royalty so as a way to implement a profit split? And these questions pop up from time to time. The other question, also very interesting, is how in tax audit or in an APA situation, multinationals encounter the market intangibles arguments, arising of local marketing intangible after some years of localized marketing activities, as well as considering the location specific advantages such as cost saving and as well as the market premiums, and also what is the new rule of implication from a transfer pricing method perspective. Will the value chain focus shake the quite prominent prevailing practice of a TNMM tests in multinational Chinese operations? The other topics we identified and we'll cover is would be service charges and royalty charges, and these are day-to-day important for the German multinationals. And we want to also touch base on the MAP, the multi agreement procedure, as well as the advanced pricing agreement procedures in China, and see what the trend, do they go in the direction that helps our multinationals in future. And lastly, we will also talk a little bit about these customs and tax interaction in the China context, which is more operational level that that our clients have been having difficulty with. So with that, I will first pass the topic about IP and license to Qi Shen.
Thank you, Yu. Now, the one of the common issues faced by multinationals as the set up operation in China is a intangible license, and particularly for German multinational when they set up a manufacturing entity in China, whether it's for local sales and or sometimes for even for export sales, the intangible licensing is a key issue. Now, because of the foreign exchange control requirement, implementing a licensing arrangement in China has its limitations and constraints because under the Chinese local requirements, in order for a taxpayer to remit the license payment to the principal, the IP owner, you need to go through a registration process, and unless the process is successful, the remittance becomes an issue. Under the current practice, usually that means a licensing arrangement has to be in a fixed royalty rate term or a lump sum term. A variable rate of royalty has not been commonly accepted by the government authorities, and therefore one of the challenges that many multinationals have is how to make sure the IP owner receives an arm's length level of royalty which is commensurate with the value of the intangibles. And oftentimes, multinationals face the challenge that the Chinese licensee is having a very high level of profit after royalty and subject to the challenge by the authority of the IP owner, with the challenge being the royalty paid by the licensee out of China is too low. So fixing that undervalue of the royalty requires careful planning and sufficient documentation. And one of the practical approach is indeed to explore whether actually a fixed royalty can be increased and receive appropriate approval from the government authority. And if that's the case, at least it will handle the remittance issue, and therefore potentially the local licensee can take the deduction. Now the challenge, obviously, the taxpayer in China need to be prepared to deal with is to demonstrate the increased royalty rate is consistent with the arm's length principle, and there should be sufficient documentation on that area, because an increase the royalty will likely attract the challenge from the tax authority. So have sufficient defense will be necessary. In some exceptional cases, some tax authority taxpayers have used a bilateral APA to address the royalty issue, and even in some cases, the residual profit could be paid out to the IP owner as royalty, so that in that regard, a variable rate of royalty or a lump sum royalty being the residual profit of the licensee has been implemented in some cases, but only on an exceptional basis. So the majority of the case, the fixed royalty is still something that the taxpayer will have to deal with. Back to you.
Okay, so the second topic we have raised is the marketing intangibles location specific advantages and adjustments for TNMM approach, how they are implicated by the new drafted amendments. We know that the new amendments draft has proposed a country by country reporting. Along with that, also a higher level of transparency with regard to the value chain analysis. And in from places to places in the new draft, it was talking about the value contribution related analysis, and also when you have intangibles, significant intangibles, the TNMM method would not be supportable. So this would implicate the multinational that used to have been quite comfortable with China one-sided tests. Our experience is that a lot of Chinese operations have been filing or doing their contemporaneous documentation based on a bottom line test of their overall operating income, which is TNMM analysis. However, now the Chinese authorities want to adopt a more holistic view, and if they find that this company has more significant intangibles, they will not be satisfied with just a TNMM test. And our view that this trend could lead to more profits being attributed to China, especially for those previously TNMM-based testing rewarded companies. The other thing linked to that is that the location-specific advantages and marketing intangibles, as well as other intangible issues, were discussed in the new draft in the intangible section. This new section, it talks about what are the more clearer definition of IP would be, and in considering that, it discusses to determine the specific attribution for the IP to the Chinese entity under a global value chain analysis. So this is not a surprise for us, because in the UN report, in the UN paper, China already made its clear declaration that it wants to have the location-specific advantages in the way of location saving, location cost saving, as well as market premium, and the other things such as a lower salary or more abundant market opportunities. And these location-specific advantages were required by China for the purpose of a comparability analysis. As my colleague Qi Shen just discussed, that in reality, that is in the tax audits as well as in APA discussions, a location advantage analysis has become more and more popular and being required as a prerequisite before a next step can be go on to discuss. So these would be, we see a more stronger trend that in the future German multinationals will have to deal with this. The other impact, one very realistic one, is on the tolling, contract manufacturing, tolling analysis that the Chinese practice, as well as in certain regulations, require that the material cost being deducted from the cost base, being included into the cost base for a toller. This is in contradiction to what the international practice would be, especially in contradiction to the German tax requirement in the transfer function administrative principles, where the German tax authority would require the material cost being taken out of the toller's cost base, but the Chinese tax authority wants them to be added in. So these are the those aspects that the German multinationals would need to face and perhaps start to think about ongoing in terms of location safety, marketing intangibles, and TNMM approach. So I will leave it to the next topic on the service charge and royalty to Eva.
And thanks, Yutao. Currently, we see a lot of German headquarters have concerns regarding the service fee and royalty charges to the Chinese subsidiaries. According to the Chinese law, the merchant fee cannot be deducted. Then the taxpayers always have the same question, how to distinguish the service charge and the merchant fee? In January 2014, the SAT submitted its view on this issue. They generally follows the OECD guideline, but also highlighted six tests to be considered as the judgment if the parent company can charge service fees to its related parties. I just give you some examples. For instance, the first one is the benefit test. This test should be performed from both the perspectives from both the service provider and the recipient. For example, in case the service provider benefits more from the services than the service recipient, then no service fee should be charged. The next one is called the need test. Because the Chinese tax bureau thinks that China is a manufacturing-based economy, like the world factory, so some kind of high-end services like advisory and legal services may not be needed by a single function manufacturing entity in China. And another tax is called the remuneration test. It tests whether the services have already been remunerated through the other related party transactions. For example, if a parent company has already provided the intangible assets like brand or the technical know-how to the subsidiaries and has already shared the residual profit, and then this parent company cannot charge additional management fee to the Chinese entities. Furthermore, in August 2014, SAT also released a tax circular to request the local level tax bureaus to launch a comprehensive tax examinations on the significant service fee and royalty payments made by the Chinese subsidiaries. For example, in Beijing, tax bureau already prepared a list of companies with significant amount of service payment and asked them to provide detailed explanation for the service charge. And in Shanghai, tax bureaus started to investigate companies whose service and royalty are above 30 million RMB, or the royalty is above 5% of the total revenue during the fiscal years 2004 to 2013. Another common issue regarding the service fee is that sometimes service fee might be deemed as royalty, which is subject to the 10% withholding tax in China. For example, we often see that the technical support service also included in the license agreement, and sometimes the IT support services will also be deemed as a royalty. Due to the different tax implication for the service fee and royalty in China, the German headquarters could maintain the documents and internally differentiate the royalty from the service fee in advance in order to avoid the potential challenges from the tax authority. As Qishen mentioned before, since there could be special requirements for how to document the service charge in the new Chinese TP regulations, it's advisable for the German headquarters to review the current service charge mechanism, prepare sufficient documentation considering the 6 tests to support the service charge at a headquarters level. Besides the service fee, another hot topic is the high and new technology enterprise status that the German headquarters need to pay attention to. The high and new technology enterprises can enjoy reduced corporate income tax rate of 15%, and such status was encouraged by many local tax authorities in the past. However, starting from 2012, the SAT has become aware of these issues and urged the local tax authorities to carry out the investigation in this area, especially for the new and high technology enterprises who still pay a royalty payment to the overseas parent companies. The strict scrutiny during the tax investigation might cause the Chinese high and new technology enterprises to face a risk of clawback the tax incentives for the past, as well as the surcharge and penalty. Further to that, with the development of the BEPS, the application of the high and new technology status become more and more difficult in the recognition procedures. In the view of above, it's advised that the German headquarters to start paying more attention to the potential challenges with this aspect, especially that the Chinese entities with significant royalty payment. Early planning or subsequent improvement can mitigate this tax risk. Let me get it back to Qishen for the next topic.
Thank you, Eva. I want to give a brief update on the APA and MAP process first. As we clearly expect that with the implementation of the BEPS, multinationals will likely face more uncertainties or uneven interpretation of the BEPS and transfer pricing rules from different countries. In China, the taxpayers' interest in APA as well as MAP has certainly significantly increased in the last few years. However, due to the BEPS-related activities, the progress in processing the BEPS, MEP and ATA cases have been significantly delayed in the last 2 years. The main issue is indeed the Chinese tax authorities' limited resources. At the moment, as of now, China, the SAT has only about six people dealing with all the MAP and ATA cases, so that is significantly a constraining factor. So far, China has, as of 2014, the latest published annual report on APA, China has concluded 43 bilateral APAs and about 70 unilateral APAs. Most of those bilateral APAs are with Asian countries, namely Japan and Korea, and the second is with European countries, mostly with Denmark and Switzerland. So far, there has been no concluded APA with Germany, but there are cases being in progress. And actually, in early July, the China-German competent authority meeting will resume after a while. Under the concluded APA, TNMM is still the most common used methodology, followed by the cost plus, which mainly is used in the unilateral APA. Given the resource constraint, the Chinese tax authority have indicated that they will probably prioritize more on the MAP cases to resolve double taxation issues that have already resulted. And also more significant resources are going to be added. So there is hope that we will see more activity from the tax authorities in China to work on the MAP and ATA cases to provide the necessary relief from double taxation or provide certainty that taxpayer is seeking. The final slide that I will touch briefly is on the interaction between customs and tax. In China, these are actually administered by two different government authorities. One is customs, the other being the SAT. However, we have seen increasing interest by the customs in the transfer pricing documentation, and it's very common nowadays for customs authorities to actually request transfer pricing documentation when they review and evaluate the custom declaration of a taxpayer. So this is certainly something that need to be aware of and make sure that in the documentation it will not create issues that potentially pose a challenge in front of the customs authorities. There's also a nationwide scrutiny on outbound royalty payment by customs. And the customs authorities are taking a position on many post-importation utilization of intangible being something that that potentially being dutiable. So this is certainly that something need to be paying attention to. Customs authority have also recently revised the declaration form to add a field to disclose whether the transacting parties are related party, and also indicating whether that their pricing has been affected by the existing of such relationship. This is also something that multinational need to be aware of. There's a slight good news is that in some customs, they have also showed interest in WCO's guide to custom valuation and transfer pricing, and they are interested in knowing more about the transfer pricing methodologies and how to reconcile with their valuation method. But this is still something in the earliest stage and something worth keep an eye on. Back to you, Axel.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Kisheng and Itao Eva. Yeah, let's come to our question and answer session. I have already collected a few questions. If you have another question, feel free to use the chat functionality or drop us the email. The first question here, Kisheng, that's maybe a good question for you. There is a company, one of the participants saying that they have several legal entities in different regions, and they have seen that the practice deviates in each region. Is there some hope that this will change through the new legislation, or what is the outlook here?
There's always hope, but unfortunately, the reality is because the Chinese regulation leaves a lot of room for local interpretation. So the implementation of the tax law and regulation is still uneven among different localities. So one way to look at this is China, because it's so large, different provinces and localities, they indeed often have different interpretations. So the hope is that the SAT continue trying to enforce and consistency, but in the near future, that remains an issue that a taxpayer has to deal with.
Okay. The next question, maybe it's a good question for you, Eva, is on the master file. Is it required to prepare that in Chinese, or is it sufficient to have it in English, as the OECD has, well, I would say clearly articulated that English should be okay for the master file. Eva, can you give us an answer on that question?
Yes, the draft regulation requires all the contemporaneous documentation should be prepared in Chinese. This is the same as the original tax circular in the past, but the central master file can definitely be prepared in English for the management to review. In that case, a translation on that is necessary.
Okay, thanks. Then I have a question here on year-end adjustments. Do you want to answer that? The question here is if we expect that there is a change of practice on year-end adjustments. I think, to my knowledge, it's very difficult, or none of my clients have been successful to implement that. The question is there a change in that practice?
Well, so far, the year-end adjustment is still a difficult thing to do. In the old regulations, there is a discussion about if you want to adjust upward, you can adjust in your tax return. But there is no discussion about whether you can adjust downward for China. So the adjustment when we are talking about is mainly about whether you want to pay more services out of China and these things. It has become still unclear and difficult because you have no concrete procedure to fall on. So we see in practice some kind of, like, say, time-related treatment or in specific case, special justification. Yeah.
Okay. Well, thanks a lot. I have to look a bit on the time. So unfortunately, we have only 1 minute left. So let me use that to make advertisement for our next webinar, which we will hand on the 22nd of June by Ludger Wellens and some of our foreign PwC colleagues. So we want to cover where we are with the transfer pricing documentation, implementation of the BEPS initiative, And we have grabbed a few countries, Poland as an Eastern European country, Spain and the UK. But Lutka will also give us a broad overview where we are with the implementation in the countries. So for further information, you have here the
Sorry everyone, we have a technical cut, but we'll be very quickly that for further questions, please feel free to send us via the email, which is on the last page of this presentation. We will be able to come back to you on your opening questions on an individual basis. Thank you very much for joining our webinar, and we look forward to seeing you in the next webinar.